Hello, everybody. Get my stand together here. There we go. I don't know if that lamp is going to act right for me back there. Let me invite. Oh, here we go. It want to start looping. Paul, I'm inviting you to come on camera. Hello, everyone. Paul, you should have an invite for you to come on camera. So, while we're waiting on Paul to log in with us, there you go. Okay. Hey, Brother Paul.
Yeah. Hey, how are you?
Don't you love technology?
Yes, when I can figure it out.
You got it. You got it. That's all that matters. You got it. Hello, Phyllis. Hello, yeah. Richard. Walk the talk. An awesome, awesome speaking program. If you want to get involved, reach out to Richard Brendan. Hello, Carolyn. Catherine, invite someone, ask someone to join us. Paul is full of knowledge and understanding, and I'm excited that my big brother, he's not my blood brother. Well, he's my blood brother in Jesus, right? You're my blood brother in Jesus. He's my other big brother. I have two natural brothers, and I have Paul is my other big brother. So I invited Paul to come on tonight and talk about his experience with the father lost form when he attended my first one. And he probably came to the second one too. And then that experience as well, just what is the role of a father and why are fathers so important? Why should men and teenage boys bring your sons, bring your grandsons to this conference on April the 7th? And then what are you going to be talking about? So we got about four things we want to touch on here. So first of all, tell our listeners a little bit about you and then talk about your experience at the Father Lost Forum.
Okay, my name is Paul Bateman. I am a minister, elder at the Streams Church, as well as a founder, co-founder of Drive-By Prayer Vigil. And we are, and you know, the Father's Forum, I am so excited about that simply because I know what it did for me. I know how it impacted my life, how it changed my life, and my relationship with my own father. We had been estranged from one another for about 30, 35 years because of the way we grew up. It was very abusive. But when I left the Father's Forum, I left with the purpose in my heart to start the conversation, to start the healing.
Wow. Good.
And to only God. Yes. Yeah, so, you know, I encourage everyone to come out to the Father's Forum because it has something for everyone. If you are a father or if you are in a situation where you are modeling fatherhood, that doesn't necessarily mean what you have to be your biological, but if you are in position to where you are parenting are providing instruction, particularly to our young African-American males. You know, I encourage you to come out, because the father's form is not necessarily just about fathers. It's about building bridges. It's about connections. It's about intergenerational connections as well. Yeah. So I'm encouraging you. I mean, the father form is not for everybody, but it is for somebody. And if you are somebody, this form is
Can
for
I,
you.
May I add something right there? I said, someone asked me, who is the father form for? I said, the father form is for anyone who had a father or is a father. You know, we all may not have a relationship with our father, and it may not be the best relationship, even if we have one. But the fact that you came into this world through the seed of a man, there is something, I believe, whether you are the senior man or the millennial or the teenager, that the father form will give them something. I mean, you're what, 50? What?
I was 64.
You're 64. Okay, so this, you were 59 or so then, or 8. And even a mature man who loves God still knew that there was something missing in his father-son relationship, and you received something.
Well, let me say this. I came there as a father, but I left there as a son.
Paul, I wish I could type at the same time, because I would be tweeting stuff. That is so good.
So the father's form is not necessarily about fathers per se. It's about the sons as well, because your sons can gain understanding of why or what a father should be and why some of the challenges that we have with our fathers.
That's good.
And that's what prompted me to go and build the bridge to start the healing process.
I remember you told me it's you guys went to breakfast or something like the next day or the next weekend or something.
Yes. And so I don't have anything to offer. If you are a son, you have a lot to gain as well.
Yeah.
So I'm excited. I'm excited about our special guest, Marvin Sapp, coming. I'm excited about the workshop. I looked at the roster and everything of all the people that are going to be teaching in the workshops as well. I'm excited about the workshop that I am going to be presenting, simply because, you know, when you look at how to rebound from being incarcerated, you have to think about you have to look at it from my own personal experience. I would be given tools that the Lord gave me,
my God,
to overcome the incarceration.
While you were there, and or when you got out, or both?
While I was there, because I understood the purpose when I got there, but it was more importantly when I got out, because then I had to rebuild my life, and I couldn't allow the shame nor allow the fact that I had a felony to reduce me to I'm going to be in prison all my life.
In your mind, that's good, because you knew you were getting out. You know, I want to say, if I can just give a little bit, and certainly you can actually give that. What all were you doing before you, because we know you went, you were incarcerated for something that you did not do. It wasn't your intent. You just got caught up with the wrong person who kind of threw you under the bus, so to speak. But all the things that you were doing, and the reason I want you to kind of touch on that is because you said something to me. You said you didn't deal with guilt because you knew you weren't guilty, but you had to deal with the shame. Mm-hmm. And so can you talk about that?
Yes. Well, you know, in 2007, I became an ordained minister, but I also became a city councilman. And I had a lot of people who looked up to me from that standpoint. There were things that I did in the community. I was well known in the community, in the political arena, as well as in the church as well. And there were a lot of people who looked up to me that I felt that I had let down. During the time that I was going through the process prior to going to prison, one thing that stuck in my mind that the Fed said, they told me that we realized that you didn't do these things, but what he said that I was really a crash dummy, that this guy was the mastermind, you was a crash dummy, but ignorance is no excuse. He said, but because of who you are, you're going to prison. You see, and I never forgot Jesus. That.
So sometimes the favor of the Lord is what the enemy will come after. Not, that says something. That's still way. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I couldn't allow them to define who I was. I had to define who I was going in and coming out. I had to believe I had to say what God said about me. So I started crafting my confessions.
Okay.
I started crafting my confessions and my daily things that I would say to myself.
Your daily declarations.
My daily declarations. But it was about what God has said that I was. Yeah. So there are three things that I want to talk about. And if they don't get anything else out of my seminar, I want them to get this. It's called the three C's.
Okay.
Conditions, cognitions, and
startle, say them again.
Conditions. Your conditions describes your circumstance that affect the way in which you live, especially live or work in regards to your well-being.
Conditions.
Cognitions is basically your mental process, or in this case, it's what you say about your conditions.
That's good, Paul.
And your choices, meaning that there are two or more that you would make based on what you say. So you can either make good choices or bad choices. You can, you have that angel on one shoulder and you have the devil on the other, and they both speaking into your spirit. And you have to make a decision. You know, Apostle Paul put it this way: the things I should do, I don't do. The things I should
do. That's what he said. Over in Romans 7.
So you have to make a decision based on your cognitions. And we're going to talk about that. We're going to flesh that out. And then we're going to start talking about how to craft your confessions.
You know, you're saying because even right there, who have been incarcerated, they may or may not have children. They may or may not have a relationship with their father, but the very fact that there's someone who will be at this Father Forum Men's Conference that can speak to where they once were and help them, because you had to keep a relationship with your wife and your children while you were incarcerated. How did you do that?
Well, that was the hardest part. Being incarcerated, people go to jail all the time and go back. And I realized why, because you learn how to live in prison. And if you keep your mouth shut and you know, just mind your own business, you can survive. Okay. So the penalty for me was the separation from my family. And that was the hardest thing for me to accept, simply because, as you well know, my wife is on dialysis and we run at home. And she needs me, and leaving her, it's just like ripping my heart out. And so I had to allow the Lord to be God.
Now I want you to finish, but I want to tell all of these people that are listening and watching. You need to tag somebody. You need to share this, because there is somebody that you know in your family or a friend that was incarcerated. Or they may be, their wife is here, or their girlfriend is here, or their children are here, and they are away. And Paul has walked this walk. And so he's about to give us some tools. He just gave us the three C's, what the men will get when they come to the conference. But now just how he kept his relationship with his wife and his children, which as you're about to share this, I'm thinking, by keeping the relationship, it may have made it easier when you came out to continue in that relationship. So go on and continue to share.
Now, before I went, my oldest son says, Dad, he asked me this question. He says, Dad, I know who you are. You don't have to explain nothing. I know who you are. You know, you a giver and not a taker. You have all your life. So I know that you didn't commit those crimes. He says, but I'm going to propose this to you because this is what the Lord spoken to my spirit. He said, suppose the Lord wants you to go to prison because there's something he has for you to do. He says, would you do
it? Wow. Wow.
And I refuse to answer the question.
I'm with you. Because we was praying because, that you weren't going.
Yeah, absolutely. But then he looked at me and says, answer me. He says, could I get an answer? He says, if the Lord wanted you to disapprove, would you do it? And I had to answer, yes. Mm-hmm. Not thy will, but thy will be done.
Yeah.
And because that's the crossroads that a lot of us are going to have to come to. There's going to be something that God is going to ask us that goes beyond your comfort.
Good God Almighty. I feel like I'm there right now doing this men's conference. I mean, this ain't like prison, but you know what I'm saying? Just him stretching me to do something that's out of the norm for a woman.
Absolutely. There are challenges. And Jesus, so
Shama,
I said, I was there for the first day I got there. You know, I'm telling you, the devil wanted to sift me like wheat because it was almost like being on the block. If you understand how to negotiate and matriculate on the block, you can survive. And I knew I was going to be okay.
Okay. Say, because before Jesus, you knew what the block looked like.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. I love Paul. Y'all know.
So I got.
It's going to be real. I love Misa Paul Bateman and his wife.
So I got there. When I got there the first day, you know, I was like, okay, I see how this is going to go. But I noticed that every time you had to stand up for count. Every time they counted four times a day, you had to stand up for they counted everybody. But there was this one individual that they just let sleep in the bed for 2 weeks.
Oh,
and they would go to make sure
okay, that this is good, y'all. Listen.
And so I said, well, why is it they not making this guy stand up? He said, well, he has cancer. They just waiting on him to die. I said, okay. I said, I'm going to go over there and pray for this guy. The Lord prompted me in my heart to go over and pray for him. So I introduced myself. And I told him who I was. I told him I wanted to pray for him. I asked him, did he believe?
Mm-hmm.
He says, yes. I said, no. I said, I believe if you believe, you can be healed.
Come on.
But you got to know the healer. Do you believe? He says, yes. I said, do you know the healer that I'm talking about? He says, yes, my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And that was
all you needed.
So I began to pray for him. I went in, but it wasn't a very long prayer. But
and
I went
you
in.
We're talking about you being incarcerated behind bars in prison your first few days there.
This was 8 days after I was there.
Come on. After that's something right there.
Yeah, 8 days. 8 days. So you're right. So the next morning, they woke me up and said, old school, you need to go out there and see Bill. I said, well, what's wrong with Bill? I'm thinking that they took him on. He said, no. He said, he's out there in line, the child line. I said, really? He says, yes.
Hey.
He said, I said, well, who's prisoning? Because he had a wheelchair. He says he got his own wheelchair. And the thing about it, he's pushing the wheelchair.
He's pushing the chair.
Now, this man pushing the wheelchair. Now, he had been laying in the bed for the 8 days that I was there and probably even longer. Now, he was up and they said, what did you do? I said, I didn't do anything. I prayed for him and I asked the Father to do it. The next few days, I had gang members, leaders of gangs, and everything coming over to me and telling me their situation, their story. They told me that I heard what you did for Bill and could you pray for my family? There was one guy whose daughter was being molested by whose mother had gave the daughter to the dope dealer and she was like 12 years old and being molested. And oh my God, I mean, he came to me and he was ready to go AWOL, get out of there. And we prayed right there on the yard. And I told him, I said, well, if you want prayer, let me just do it right now. I said, you ashamed? He says, no. I said, let's do it right now. So we pray right there on the yard. And, you know, you got to be, everybody's
come on
the yard, okay? And so we prayed right there on the yard. The next day he came back and told me that the guy got arrested.
Glory to God. See, we, you know, this is just blessing me. Rasha said to tell you, hey, two of her favorite people. She get to listen to your niece. Let me tell you, what people don't understand, I'm going to be honest. I don't want that to be my cross to bear, to go to jail, so that I could be a witness for the Lord. But I remember, and I'm sure I wasn't the only person, but I remember saying to you, God has put a Joseph anointing on you, and your very name being Paul. New Testament, Paul was doing all types of stuff in prison. And so, how God just this double anointing, because before you went in, the favor of the Lord was very evident upon you. And we still declare, which is Joseph's anointing, and we still declare that favor is still upon you. Yet there was this place you had to be in. My God.
Well, had to when be I was God, released.
Wow. The day, you know, we can play with that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. The day that I was released.
Bless you, Sharon. Go ahead, brother.
I started two prayer groups in two different dorms. By the time I left there, there was 100 people in each of them. It is still on today. At the end of the day, we always pray. Give scripture. We sing some songs. Give scripture. Break the scripture down. And then we would pray. And then we would sing. And there was some singing.
I bet.
They would open up the doors so we could hear it throughout the day.
Wow.
So the day that I left,
and you were released, I was going early, to the ministry.
Yes, I was given 36 months. I did 10 and a half months. They modified the thing. Because Pastor Hill was picking me up. And as I was going through, there were men standing on each side of the sidewalk. And as I walked through, each one of them laid their hands on me and was praying over me. And I'm telling you, man, by the time I got to the end of the line, I was in tears.
You had your own fire tunnel.
The guard said, he's he says, I've never seen that as long as I've been here.
Who said that?
The lady administration, she was in tears.
Wow.
The CO. And then the lady administration, you know, she was in tears. She says, I don't know who you are or what you did, but I've never seen this as long as I've been here. And so that was my experience there. So coming home, I'm coming home with mixed emotions. I don't know how to feel, who to trust, or anything. And all I just wanted to do was get with my family and see my family. But also knew that there was a world out there waiting on me. And I had to make the decision to understand who I was in Christ and not let nobody define who I was.
And some of that, you were able to maintain that while you were there because of your personal confessions. And
yes, absolutely. And so,
because you wasn't no jailhouse born again Christian, you came already saved and filled with the Holy Ghost.
Oh yeah. My mission was to make more disciples. That was my goal every day. And so, you know, coming home, I had to make sure that I practiced my affirmations every day as to who
when
I
you
was.
Got home.
And
okay,
yes,
okay.
When I got home, because I heard. There was no doubt who I was. They understood. They appreciated it because I was pure.
You came in one way,
It's I didn't come in and get it like you said. I came in one way and I left the same way. But coming home was a different thing because I knew that there were people that were judged,
Jesus is Lord.
And I had to get set free from people's opinion first of all. And I had to say about me what God said
That's
about
good.
Me and begin to craft my confessions and make sure that I had daily affirmations of who I was and not allow this the system to choke me down. Because you see, the thing about it, Harriet Tubman said this, she would have freed a lot more slaves had they known they
had
were slaves.
Had they known.
Yeah. And any time that you come home from prison and allow the system to choke you down and you stuck right there in prison, even though you were outside the walls, you were in prison in your mind. And you have to break that cycle. Now, in order to break that cycle, you have to understand who you are in
Christ. You said something. I'm stuck on Harriet Tubman right now because that says something. That's a sea lie. You got to really think of, you got to chew that because they were so conditioned that this was their way of life. They didn't realize
to be enslaved.
They were slaves. This is why people don't understand that Juneteenth, you know, why Juneteenth was so important. And because we were free, but people were still living as slaves because the message had not been gotten to them. So they were free. But even once they came and freed them physically, there's still a mental freedom that you have to be delivered from.
Well, you see, they never abolished slavery. The 13th Amendment states this, that it prohibits slavery with the exception of punishment for crime.
Jail.
So if you are commit a crime, then you become a slave. Become a slave. And you come out with a slave mentality.
Paul, you didn't say something again.
Just like you do. So Reconstruction, they had a period of Reconstruction after slavery was ended. Reconstruction means they had to redo a portion of mind for this country as well as individuals. Yeah. They had to reconstruct the process, reconstruct how you think. So coming out of prison, there's a reconstruction. You have to reconstruct what your thought process is, how you act, your behavior, everything.
Oh, Jesus, I'm telling you, I don't know who's tagging, who's sharing, who's inviting, but y'all need to get y'all men on April 7th to the Father for Men's Conference at Westside Baptist Westside Church, NBC. You need to get them there on La Paz Trail because this is going to be good. This is going to be good. I said no estrogen in the sanctuary or the breakouts, but I might have to go put a hat on and sit in the back because this is good. Yeah. This is good. So you got home, you formed your, you continued with your confessions and your affirmations. How long did that process of the opinions of man, did it take you to be free from?
Well, I was free from them immediately. What I wasn't free from was the financial obligations that was unjustly placed on me. And that took me, that gave me a tailspin, to be honest with you. And so, but because the Lord is
my shepherd, he is.
I shall. And I had to rest in him. I had to believe that the same God that took care of my wife while I was in away from her, you know, she never went to the hospital, not one time.
Not one time.
As soon as I got home, she went to the hospital twice within a 6 to 7 month period. But she never had to go to the hospital. I mean, he took care of her. He's a keeper. So the same God that took care of her then is the same God that's taking care of us now.
Yes, Lord.
So we haven't missed a meal. I mean, everything is okay. And so now I am campaign manager for Bill Benjamin, who's running for sheriff.
Now, I love God. Don't you love his 360 moments? He's just amazing. He is a covenant-keeping God. We better get it. Oh, God.
You have to. There's no way that I should be a campaign manager coming out of prison for an individual.
Not the dog catcher, but the sheriff.
The sheriff. Yeah.
Marion County Sheriff, you know, God is running for, right?
Marion County Sheriff. Bill Benjamin. Let me put that out there as a shameless plug.
No, it ain't shameless.
But Bill Benjamin. Yeah, he's running for Marion County Sheriff. He's a godly man. He's a God-fearing man. We pray about everything, every decision, everything that we do. And when we win this, we know that God did it because we wasn't the
first. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. So yeah. Before we continue, let's just put this out there since we're talking about this. Folk voting in 2018, let's just let the previous city councilman who's now the campaign chairman for the sheriff, just talk to the people who are listening and will hear this later. We'll get back to the conference, how important it is to vote in November.
Well, I tell you what, Bill Benjamin, he already has a platform. He understands both sides. He was a Marion County sheriff, but he also worked in IMPD. Mm-hmm. He was deputy of investigations. The man had an 81% clearance rate when you're talking about murder.
Yeah.
He was the one that killed the guys at Hovey Street.
I remember that.
He turned them in. He called the guys at Hamilton Street. He caught them personally. Mm-hmm. At the expos, Seamus Patterson shot 7 people up over there. He was caught within 48 hours. He called the guy that killed the policeman over here off of 34th and Keystone. He called him within 24 hours. He is a man. He has an 81% clearance rate of all murders. And when you catching people like that, then all other crime goes down.
Yes, sir.
Because they.
So overall, why? And we going to vote for Brother Benjamin. I'm totally with Paul on that because for a season, I was helping with that. With his campaign, but just people coming out to vote in general, what do you have to say about that? Wherever they live, not just Indiana or Indianapolis.
I'll say this, that, you know, because the fact that we were denied the right to vote, there's so many people who died for our privilege to vote, that it would be a shame not to exercise your God-given privilege to vote. You know, I was thinking about the other day. I was talking to my nephew and how the Constitution said that we were only 3/5 of a person. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because and as a result of that, they denied you the privilege to vote because it was one man, one vote.
And you weren't a full man.
But if you three, you couldn't vote. And now here we are in 2018, and we cannot have voter apathy.
Come on.
Because voter action is the thing that allows us to have the administration that we have today. Had particularly African Americans voted, we would have a different administration.
Absolutely, we would.
Now,
absolutely.
Saturday, you look at what happened in Alabama when you had a pedophile running for the Senate. Black folks came out and voted.
Yeah.
And because they came out and voted, it made the difference. Now you have a mayor in Minnesota.
They said the black women moved that vote.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, they did. You have, as a result of the black women in Minnesota, you have a mayor in Minnesota,
Atlanta.
A black man. That's a mayor in Minnesota. You have a sister in Atlanta that's a mayor. And they almost had the first white Caucasian mayor of Atlanta in over 30 years. As a result of the fact that black folks don't vote. So you can't minimize the fact that you only one person, one vote. You got to look at the collective, how collectively we have
one of the things I say, we know we served in prayer ministry together. We're praying people. Pray, but act. I always say that. Get up off your knees and do something. Stop talking about what needs to be done. We need to pray about it. You have to act. One of your rights is kingdom, but then you have some natural authority rights that are given to you through voting. Utilize both of them, and a lot of times, particularly as Christians, we think, well, vote. You know, I'll pray about it, and who God wants. No, we are in the earth and have been given authority in the earth to act.
That's right.
And we have not only a spiritual responsibility, but we have civic responsibilities.
Well, let me say it like this. I think it's Isaiah 9:6. It says, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given,
and the government.
And the government of the world would be upon his shoulders. You see, in other words, God has called us to infiltrate in every area of the government. He wants his kingdom.
Because the shoulders can't move without the body, and we're the body.
Come on.
Yeah, and we work me. But Rasha said, that's right, that the local vote is even more important than the national vote. We need to, our local elections matter, midterms matter.
All politics is local.
It starts there.
And
huh?
Then it goes national.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because the laws, the policies, and the legislative policies that are drafted here affect us immediately.
Yes, immediately.
And immediately. So, you know, you can't wait for a national ticket to come to energize everyone to vote on a local level. You have to take upon yourself to understand that the city services, the dollars that are going to your neighborhood are predicated on who's in power. And I learned that as a city councilman, because I was in there when we didn't have control of the council, and I was there when we did. When we didn't have control of this council, I didn't get sidewalks, I didn't get sewers and other city services in my area. The basics that we need as citizens of Marion County, I didn't receive those things. They went into the other.
And I know people don't leave us. I know we're here to talk about the Father Forum, but Paul was in politics, and I've wrestled with the thought to run, and God hasn't released me to do it yet. But I'm very concerned about our communities, and I'm very concerned that a lot of times we only equate Christianity to Republicans. But there are devout, if we want to use that word, lovers of Jesus who are Democrats and independents, and even those who don't vote. Republicans do not hold the Trump card, so to speak, the Jack of Spades on, or the Ace of Spades on Christianity. And so whatever your political party is, you need to vote and be open to say, I love Jesus too. And even loving Jesus as a Democrat, there are parts, because it has nothing to do, honestly, with party, in my opinion. There are things that have nothing to do with, if someone gets an abortion, that has nothing to do with party. If someone is homosexual, that has nothing to do with party. If someone commits a crime, what happened in Florida, that has nothing to do with party. That has to do with principle that comes from a relationship for me with Jesus Christ. That's my soapbox.
Well, you have to understand that people that are in politics, their job is to legislate. It is our job as men and women of God to disciple. And if we are doing our job, then we can cut down on some of the things that you just mentioned. And I think that it is incumbent upon us to do what Jesus asked us to do, which is to go out and
let's be clear, the Bible is very clear. There were cities of refuge in the Bible. I always say Jesus was pro-life. I mean,
absolutely.
There's so much. I mean, we will get off because you know me and you could just go for days. But I'm going to let you finish the last thought on this whole voting need, and then we'll get back to the conference.
Well, I just want to say that, you know, even as a politician, I felt that God gave me a territory, a district to reign over. And to introduce his kingdom in that area, and as much influence as I could have in
and his kingdom
arena.
Is what, Paul?
Well, his kingdom is his reign, his rule, and his authority.
That's right.
That's what the kingdom of God
is. That comes
is.
From his word.
His reign, his rule, and his authority. That comes from the word.
His word, the scripture. But the Bible says the kingdom of God is not about, you know, I'm paraphrasing, but it's of power. It's of love. Mm-hmm. You know, his kingdom is clear that it is to come into the earth. And when we are Christians, we should be representing the kingdom of God, which is ultimately the love of God, not compromising, not winking our eye at sin or what people are doing, but even in the midst of sin, loving people, say, hey, you know, I still can love you, though that's what you're doing. I can still love you. I ain't got to agree with it. And I'm okay with publicly saying that I don't agree with your lifestyle. Mm-hmm. But I can still love you. And God can transition your heart. And once your heart is changed, your behavior will change. We're so busy trying to legislate people's loins. Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
Legislating people's loins and their morality. You can't do that. That comes from through a relationship with God. And we say a relationship with God through Jesus Christ.
Absolutely. And I believe that, you know, during this season, I believe that, you know, when people ask me about the current administration, I let them know that the Bible says that he will give us rulers and leaders after our own hearts.
Well,
so this is just a reflection of America. This is a microcosm of America. And I believe that it's done so that he's calling us back to our first love, which is him. And, you know, there are going to be many more days when we're going to call on him as a result of what's going on right now. And I believe that there's going to be an awakening that's coming and coming soon. And the people have to get ready.
Yeah, we got to be ready.
Because
that's the scripture I was trying to think of was in Corinthians. It says the kingdom of God is not of talk, but it's of power. It's of action. And so so that's what we want to see. We want everybody, we didn't get off track. We know what we're doing. Get out and vote. November, no, is it the 3rd or the 6th, Paul? Do you remember?
Well, actually, it's the 2nd, but November, May the 8th will be the primary. We asking everyone to come out and vote early. Early vote eliminates some of the confusions at the polls. You don't have to show that other stuff. You don't have to go through all the changes. Just come in and vote early, and your vote is cast, and you don't have to worry about all the other confusion. We ask that you come out early, May
8th,
and vote. And make sure that we lift up Brother Benjamin. The attacks on him is severe. We have formed an intercessory group to pray over him and pray over our team.
Amen.
So I just asking everybody to continue to pray for us and come out and vote.
May 8th. Amen. So back to the Father Forum on April. The Father Forum Men's Conference on April the 7th here in Indianapolis. It's open to all men of all ages, the adult mature male, the millennial, as well as the teen. And one of the things I wanted to put teens in the space and the place where mature men were and men who were closer to their age, because I think we've lost this place where we used to learn from our elders. And men learn by examples, by what they see. Women learn by what they hear. And so our first means of learning. And so that's why I wanted teens in the same place. So I just bring your sons, your grandsons, your nephews, your brothers, bring your men's ministries, your fraternal orders, the men at the church. And we're still raising funds. We've met half of our budget. We'll be announcing on Monday our presenting sponsor, and the press release will go out. But we're also still raising dollars. And so one of the things I wanted to do, Brother Minister, was I was asking churches to come alongside and send churches and organizations to sponsor sending 20 men. And then if 10 churches did that, we would put 200 men in the sanctuary. And that really would take care of the conference, the balance of the conference. So just believe with me that God is going to do that, whether it's other organizations that come alongside or churches send their men. But, okay, how can you support? I will post the link. I'll post the link for you to support. Amen. I appreciate that. So what should you say, or what do you want to say as we wrap up, Brother Minister, to encourage, whether it's the man who was incarcerated, or a father who has a son who's incarcerated, or that statement you made, you came to the Father lost form as a father, but you left as a son. That's a tweetable. Mm-hmm. That right there is so good. Mm-hmm. And before I have you share that, let me just kind of give people a really quick of how we got to this place with the conference. The Father Forum brought men together to talk about father issues. And I would bring mm-hmm. women in separate settings to separate setting to talk about their father issues. The men would come together and I would have 2-3 hours set aside, and I look up and we would be there 4 hours. So I really mm-hmm. just took my direction to focus on the men. And so we looked at 6 areas where, as children, young people are impacted. They're impacted financially, emotionally, spiritually, socially, relationally, and mentally by the loss or absence of a father. And when we talk about loss, it's not that he's passed away. It's that sometimes it's not always that a father is absent, meaning that you don't know who he is, because your father and your dad worked in the same plant, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You want to talk about that real quick before I go on?
And that was really interesting. That was a very interesting thing because, you know, I was really good at baseball, and, you know, whenever I was in the paper, my stepdad would say, "Look at my son." And now my father would want to talk about his son, and my stepdad was like, "Well, he lives with me."
Come on now.
I taught him everything he knows. Right. So I mean, it was just an interesting dynamic to have them both there and have them both. One was a more or less. An instructor.
Okay.
He taught me everything, hunt, fish, everything. I mean, even things of the world. And then the other was just there. And it was very strange. It was a very strange relationship. You know, whenever I would go to work and I would see him.
Oh, you worked in the same plant as your dad? I didn't know that.
All three of us were there.
Wow, I didn't know that.
And yeah, it was just very strange to go in and look at somebody that is supposed to be my seed, that I'm a seed of, and have no relationship with them.
And what we started out saying was that, you know, because there are people coming on just to kind of catch them up, that, you know, prior to the Father Lost Form, which was in 2011 or 2012, you had an estranged relationship from your dad for 33 years, but by coming to that forum, you started building this mm-hmm. relationship, and now you're his caregiver. What, 5 or 6 years later, and you are a mature man in his 50s. So this forum, the forum has birthed itself into this conference, and the conference, the day will open up with continental breakfast. We will have our opening speaker, Pastor Dr. David Hampton, Light of the World, senior pastor. You know he gonna bring it. Right after that, we have worship all day by Carlton Amos, Minister Carlton Amos. Mm-hmm. And then our workshops is Paul's workshop. I titled it Gaining After Incarceration. He may change my title. There's a workshop called How Not mm-hmm. to Lose a Million, Gaining from Loss. There's a workshop on PTSD. It's not just for soldiers. We have a workshop mm-hmm. with 2 millennials, Whitney Oliver Hamilton and Malcolm Ernest Taylor. And they're talking about how they forgave, why they forgave their fathers. One was mm-hmm. drug addicted, and one he didn't know meet until he was 23, 24 years old, mm-hmm. ever, because mm-hmm. that father was in prison. Another workshop, Jeffrey Allen II and Tyler Hill will be doing a workshop for millennials called Millennial Manhood. Then, Jamal Smith, who is now the director of athletics for IPS, he will be doing a workshop on From the Street Corner to the Office Corner. and just where he came from and Gary and how his life was, but look at him today. So you don't have to stay on the street corner, right? And though I know there are a lot of you guys who can relate to a lot of these different workshops, but where you are is where God assigned you. Pastor Hill, A. Thomas Hill, is doing a workshop on the remember, home maintenance ministry, just gaining through having a healthy marriage. And then Pastor James Jackson is doing a workshop, Fervent Prayer, doing a workshop on gaining through prayer, the power of a praying man. And Donnell, Pastor Donnell Howard, is doing a workshop on gaining through mentoring. So we have a wonderful day of workshops. There are morning workshops, then there's lunch, afternoon workshops. Morning ones will be repeated. So the men can come to at least two or three workshops. The teens can come to not only their workshops, but some of the other ones. And then we will hear from Dr. Bishop, Pastor Marvin L. Sapp. And we will finish with that. And Paul Bateman is your MC for the day. And right after Pastor Sapp is where we're going to do the reconciliation restoration ceremony, where men will stand proxy for men who have in some way hurt women. So at 2 o'clock, we're allowing women to come. You will be in a separate room until this ceremony happens. We will prepare you for that, pray with you. They will be given a piece of paper, Brother Minister, and they'll write their name on it. They'll write what their male hurt is. And then the men who have agreed, which I'm hoping you will be one of them, will line up in front of the sanctuary. We will bring those women in and just randomly place them in front of one of the men.
Lord.
And then we will give you that sheet. The women are not allowed to speak. And if I gave you my sheet, you would just read my sheet and you would say, Tuesday, I'm sorry this happened to you. I stand proxy for the man who did it and ask, will you forgive me?
Ooh, Jesus.
Yeah, God is, and only God could come up with that. Only God. And so then you can pray. You guys will pray over her, a short prayer. We will take her and take her back and then bring the next lady in. So I'm only taking 50 women because I'm not sure how many men are going to be there. But as this grows, prayerfully, we'll be able to do a full reconciliation restoration ceremony, because I believe there are women who will come who are right there to just be whole, but they just needed someone to acknowledge this happened to me. I have a young lady who told me her uncle sex trafficked her. Her uncle, not her mother's boyfriend, her uncle, her blood uncle. And so just needing to hear a man say, that should have never happened to you, and I'm sorry, and to pray over her. How many women will come that have probably never had a man pray over them? And so we will do that, and then you guys will close again by yourself in the privacy of that sanctuary with a fire tunnel, and then we'll go home.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Sounds like fun.
Yeah, it's going to be true ministry, and I just believe by the time we get to that fire tunnel, the reconciliation and the fire tunnel, the men are going to be filled and moving as prophets, priests, and kings towards what God has for them. And so registration is still open. Men, it's only $35. For teens, it's $10. My goal ultimately, Brother Paul, is that getting the sponsorships would allow the conference to be free.
Okay.
And if raising those extra dollars, those other dollars through sponsorships, then any man can come. I want the guys that are a part of IPD's transition, we're like coming out of jail, those guys, I want them to be able to come. If you know, they're trying to pay off their debt, so they may not have the money, but to be able to just tell them, come, you know. And so that's my heart's desire, that not that men won't pay, because I know they will, but I really want it to be free to anyone who wants to come. So again, anyone in the sound of my voice who desires to sow a seed towards sponsorship, and this is what I want to say. I've had people say, oh, I'll sponsor two teens or I'll sponsor five teens. That's great, but you need to get the teens there. I can't go and find the five teens. Thank you for the money. That's a blessing. But I need the teens there. God wants the kids in the building. And so thank you for the money. But if you are sponsoring three teens, get three teens from your church. If you're sponsoring 10 teens, get teens from the school, from the church, somebody, and get them in the house, because our teens are hurting. If five out of every eight children are born into a single family, we need our teens there. If 83% of our children in juvenile come from single parent homes, we need our teens there. If 93% of men incarcerated came from fatherless homes, we need our men there. If girls are seven times more likely to be molested because there's no father in the home, we need fathers there to learn how to reconnect with their children. If children, if every three out of five teens are more likely to commit suicide because a father is not present, we need our teens there.
My God.
We need our fathers there. So, and you can say until the cows come home that I'm there. My kids know who I am. But this is the acronym God gave me. Fathers are not serving their children the full pie. I said, Daddy, what do you mean? He said, I was cutting a pie. And he said, they're not serving them the full pie. Because I was like, how do I do this? I'm calm. I'm a woman. You're asking me to do this. He said, a pie. They're present, but they're not engaged. And they're not involved, and they're not engaged. P-I-E. They're present, but they're not involved, and they're not engaged. Your kids don't even know what your favorite color is. They don't know what your favorite food is. They don't know one dream you have in your life. They don't know nothing on your bucket list. I have kids, Paul, in the middle school that I'll say, what's your mom's, okay, so I'll be like, I'm calling home because you acting up. What's your mama's name? Tawana. Tawana what? Is that a real name? No, well, they call her Tawana. What's your mama's real name? How you don't know your mama's real? Where your mama work? I don't know. You don't know where your mother work? You're in the seventh grade? You're in the eighth grade? You don't know where your mom works? So we're just even, I think a lot of times, and I feel like I'm preaching, but a lot of times we think that the relationship is because I'm the dad and you're the child, I'm the mother and you're the child. No, in this time, in this dispensation, you need to build relationships with your children. Because if you don't, somebody else will, the internet will, Facebook, well, they not on Facebook, Twitter will, Instagram will, Snapchat will, YouTube will. And so if nothing else, if we can bring men into a space to understand that we know there are some crazy baby mamas out there that's keeping fathers away from their children and interfering with them having a relationship with their children. And you let us deal with them in the women's conference, okay? But but when we do that next year. But just for fathers to understand the importance of just having a relationship, being present, being involved, and being engaged. It just goes forever and a long way. Yeah, go ahead, Paul.
It makes well, you know, I would just want to say that, you know, if you kill the head, the body will fall. And as the father, as the man, the priest of the household, if he is absent, then the fabric of a family falls apart.
That's right. Because he's the head.
And he's the head. And I find that, you know, the people who are committed, regardless of whether or not you have a crazy baby mama or not, to being a parent are the ones that find that the kids are the most successful. They have confidence going to school and in anything endeavor that they try to attempt to reach, they have the confidence. Because they have that father behind them. It's something about father in the household, regardless of whether you live it with them or not, but if you are in their life, a father can make
every
the difference.
Time.
So I encourage every male that has opportunity to look at this Facebook post to reach out to their ministries, to reach out to the people that they know, to their families, and get them to this conference. I'm telling you that you're not going to be the same as you were when you come in.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, differently. You're going to leave differently. There is something for everybody. And I tell you that, you know, I'm really excited about that generational change that we're going to have. That's going to be awesome, you know, to be able to listen to some of the young kids to talk about their plight and how they're going to move through and how, and you know, Jeffrey Johnson and Tyler Hill are two of the most powerful men in this city.
Yeah.
And they are serious about their God. They are serious about serving the Lord and serious about making sure that the folks around them understand what is at stake.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm just excited about that. I'm excited about even going to their
conference. Yeah, to their workshop. And, I mean, it's going to be awesome. You know, when you were talking, I was reminded, you know, and I can't remember where the scripture was. I think it's in Genesis somewhere where the Bible says that our identity comes from the seed of God, from God, which a child's identity, yours and mine, the little one to the oldest one, it comes from the father. We thank God for the incubator, the womb of the mother where the egg was, but our identity is in the blood. Identity is in the blood, and it comes from the father. And so we have families that are walking around like headless horsemen because the head is missing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they're steady trying to understand. I mean, and I posted this several months ago when those babies said to me, "Miss Tate, I want a daddy." That I could, I mean, I drove all the way home crying. I want a daddy.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't I have a daddy? I mean, what seventh, eighth, ninth grader should even have to have that type of daddy? Right, you crying with me. We got cries going across the screen. That broke my heart. And these were all girls, but they said, "Miss Tate, I just want a daddy. Or I know who my father is, but he doesn't have a relationship with me. He has a relationship with his other kids on the other side of town, but he don't have a relationship with me." And so I know somebody could say, "Oh yeah, they're talking about the young people need." No, the fathers need to be there, because I said this to a young man the other day. I said, "It's not that your father didn't want a relationship with you. I pray, but the longer a man stays away, the more difficult it is for him to come back and reconnect. And a lot of times the guilt and the shame keeps him away." And so for those fathers who will come, we want to, these men who have been put in place want to help you to get rid of the guilt, get rid of the shame. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. You don't have to be guilty. Right. You don't have to feel shame because you haven't been around for the last 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. Start inching your way back. and believe me, it may take them some time, but whether they're 50-something, 15 or 5, they'll welcome you coming back into their lives.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, amen. Amen. Anything else you want to share, brother? And then we're going to get off here because I know you stuff going on.
Yeah. First of all, I just want to thank you for inviting me on Facebook Live. Also to be able to be a part of what is, I believe it's going to be the best Father's Forum ever.
I believe that.
And, you know, I'm excited about being a part of it. I encourage everyone to come out and be a part of what God is doing with the fathers in this season. We need our fathers to be fathers.
We need our men.
And I just want to come on out and make sure that you bring someone with you.
We need our men healthy. We need them whole. We need them operating and who and what God created them to be. I say this all the time, sweetie, I ain't threatened by no man getting in position, honey. I'm clear about who I am. Mm-hmm. And wouldn't it be a great thing to be a, beside a man who is clear about who he is. You ain't got to be threatened by that, honey. Be his cheerleader. Go put you on a cheerleading uniform and get you some pom-poms, boo. Shoot. What?
Glory to God. Well, one thing I know, I know that no woman really wants to be the man and the woman in the household. You know, if you had the opportunity, you would prefer just to be the woman and the man.
So, ladies, who have husbands and boos, you can't make them come, but encourage them to come. You can't make them come, but encourage them to come. Just encourage them to come, and maybe, you know, I said this. I said, you guys don't have to go all the way to Dallas, though. You know, T.D. Jakes is my secret. He don't know he my mentor, but he don't know he my other spiritual father. But you ain't got to go all the way to manpower. There is some manpower that's going to be right here in Indianapolis on April the 7th with some anointed men of God who are ready, filled, and equipped to speak into your life. And understand, listen, T.D. Jakes was on the backside of the mountain in West Virginia when he started Woman Thou Art Loose. Didn't nobody know who he was? So what can God possibly do with the Father Forum Men's Conference in Indianapolis that can grow to be something amazing for our men? So if you hear this and you're in Ohio, you're in Michigan, you're in other parts of Indiana, and you say, you know what? Because one of our speakers is from Kalamazoo, Michigan, the therapist that's doing the workshop on PTSD. So we Indianapolis is, we not sleeping on this. So we invite you all to come out on April the 7th. And we love you. Give my sister Beth a kiss for me. I love her with the love of the Lord. I know she's praying for me.
Thank you.
Praying for her.
Amen. Thank you.
I love you, big brother.
Opportunity. I love you too.
All right, Matthew, Barry Matthew will be with us next Saturday. So Barry, I saw you on, so get ready. All right. I love you guys. See you later. See you at church, Paul. Bye. Bye, everybody.
Okay.
Thank you. And I'll put the link for registration and to give. Bye-bye.